Hey, good morning and welcome to PMCH from church, coming to you at home. It's great to see so many people already logging on this morning. A huge, huge welcome to you if you have already beaten us to it and you've been sat there waiting. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, Ruth and Eric first up.
Hey, nice and early. Well done to the Adamses. Great to see you. And to Steve and Elizabeth, nice to see you on screen this morning.
Morning, Johnny.
And to the Libby family. Loads and loads of people logging on this morning. Do, if you're joining us, pop a comment in the chat. Give us a like. Tell us where you're joining us from this morning. Tell us where we're reaching you and speaking to you this morning. Wherever you're joining from, it's really, really great to have you. A special welcome this morning for anybody that is joining us for the first time. Maybe they've just landed in Plymouth and they've just started at Plymouth University. Huge, huge welcome to you. I know that Johnny Libby has been speaking and sharing with lots of people this week, and it's great to see you if you're joining our live stream this morning. A huge welcome to the best city in the planet.
We saw all the signs up, didn't we, as we were coming in.
Yeah, I hope you worked out which dot you were supposed to be following as to which way you were supposed to be coming into the city, whether you were blue, red, green, orange, wherever you were travelling. I hope you found your halls, your accommodation. Hope you're enjoying the great, beautiful weather here in Plymouth. It's really great to have you with us this morning. So do say hello in the comments if that's you. We look forward to meeting you and seeing you at various events. Good morning to
Mark. Can I just turn this around a minute and he can actually give you a wave?
Saying hello.
Hang on. There we go. Wave, Mark. Woo! We've got Mark on the organ.
It is the organ debut this morning. We're very, very excited.
So he's watching live.
He's watching live, which is really hilarious because that means that he's got a 15-second delay to say morning from over there. So he'll get our good morning on his screen about now, I reckon. Yep, spot on. There it was. Really, really looking forward to having the organ being played this morning. And I'm sure the many people watching will be looking forward to that too. Good morning to the Wattels. Good morning to Laura. Great to have you on this morning.
That's
and
a
Serena. I'm just going for first names there. I'm not brave. Sorry. Really, really great to have you. Morning to the Denhams. Nice to have you all online with us this morning. Really lovely to see loads and loads of people joining. As well as students arriving, the other big news, of course, this week is the start of the Fantasy Football League.
I really didn't know what you were going to say then. That could have been anything.
And the irony is, I am not into football at all, so it's really not big news for me. But the PMCH Fantasy Football League has started, and I'm sure there's lots and lots of scores on the board already after yesterday's matches. If you want to join, it's not too late. Obviously, you'll be a week behind. I know Johnny will be keen in the comments to make sure there's lots of links to add in there to people. Particularly as he's quite keen to knock somebody off the top spot, I think, this year. Yeah, there's some interesting family rivalry going on.
Yeah.
But do find the links on our Facebook page if you want to join in with that, and join in with the fun and the very God-filled open competition that will take place. There won't be any foul play, I'm sure.
There's a tongue twister for you.
Oh, the Beth Wethericks are in Falmouth. Very nice. very, very nice. I have practiced.
Really,
I've practiced that surname several times actually over the weeks in preparation for this live moment. So I hope I got it right.
I'm glad you're excited about the organ.
Yes, lots and lots of people excited about the organ, which is really, really great. Lots of other really exciting things happening this week. Our soft play centre is reopening from Wednesday, which is so awesome. We're really, really looking forward to that outreach and that work recommencing this week.
Every time I've been in this week, somebody has been washing up toys or cleaning something, and they've been really busy bees.
Yeah, really exciting. And Gareth will say a bit more about that in the proper notices, in the official notices, rather than just the mingle this morning. But there is so much good stuff to thank God for this week. Lots and lots of new things starting. Great to see lots more excitement about that little screen preview of Mark behind the organ. I think that should be our new Facebook cover page, maybe Mark's head just popping up from the organ loft over there. Really, really good to see lots and lots of comments for that this morning.
And Johnny's put the link to the fantasy football up there.
There you go. All you keen football players, obviously that is not something to do during the sermon. That is an activity to look at after the service this afternoon, because you will be glued to your screens for the sermon later on. What else have we got to say this morning? There is still some space for tonight's service if you want to if you fancy coming to church in person. And there are also some spaces. We had the first in-person Bible study this week as well, which was really well attended. Space for that again too. So do check on the Facebook page and contact if you want space for those. Lots and lots of people joining from different places this morning.
I think Marie wins for the most bizarre.
Marie is watching from the M6. That is impressive. Very good. I hope you're not the one driving and watching at the same time, because we wouldn't recommend that sort of...
Oh, the Bennetts.
And good morning to the Bennetts. Nice to see you. They've had like mega streams of celebrations over the last couple of weeks. Lots of birthdays, lots of anniversaries, loads and loads of things happening. So hope you're not too celebrated out in the Bennett household. And Linda joining us this morning too, which is great. I hope this week's been a good week for you. If you've been returning to school or to workplaces or to different activities, our children have gone back this week and our house has been bizarrely quiet, hasn't
yeah.
it? Yeah, very quiet. Having cups of tea and actually finishing them is a bit of a novelty. But the other groundbreaking activity this week was a family trip to IKEA, wasn't it? After months of being pestered by Mrs. Courtney.
My happy place.
My resolve finally gave in, and there were little dances of glee as we ascended the escalator
into
the showrooms.
It was so good.
Sat on 300 different sofas. Couldn't eat meatballs.
No.
That was a bit of a oversight. Didn't pre-book for our dining
yes,
slot.
Yes, warning people, if you're going to IKEA, pre-book your meal.
Or just don't go. It's the other piece of advice I would give there. But a very exciting trip all the same, and we've now stocked up with meatball sauce and all those things, so we're ready should a second lockdown come. We will now survive with our stocks repleted with
and
meatball
sauce.
And our plastic
storage boxes.
Ah, yes. And
new
scissors.
Cushion covers. Oh, scissors. I think every time we go to IKEA, we buy a pack of scissors. Just
yeah. And the most extraordinary device to deal with an avocado. It's like a Swiss Army knife for avocados.
Paul got a bit sick of watching me nearly put a knife through my hand at you most of the time.
Yeah, so now I'm in charge of avocado sorting, which Gareth will, I'm sure, have to. If he was Skyping in now, he'd say something about our middle-class cutlery drawer, I'm sure.
It's really dangerous, though. My hairdresser cut her hand cutting an avocado, and the paramedic said that it was one of the most common hand injuries they get in A&E is from people cutting avocados. So be careful, people.
Or go to IKEA. One of the two. Great stuff. There's loads and loads of people still logging on this morning, despite our inane chat about avocados and IKEA. Good to see you this morning, Vilma. And lots of other people too.
Good morning, Margaret
and David. Nice to see you too this morning. We've got a great service lined up for you this morning with some worship, a great sermon. If you were watching last week, you would have heard Gareth really on fire. I loved listening to Gareth's sermons last week, and you can catch that again if you missed it. Of course, all of our live videos from all of our live streams all through the last 5 or 6 months are all online, all available to watch wherever you are. If, like Marie, you're on the M6, you can still watch all of the sermons. You could bide your time in a 4-hour traffic jam just watching Gareth preaching and all of our live streams. So we're really, really looking forward to this morning, and we're really expectant for all that God will be saying to us and sharing with our hearts this morning. I hope too, as you're logging on, you feel that expectancy and you're ready and waiting for God to speak to you. It's been really exciting over the last few weeks and over the last few months to hear some of those pieces of feedback, to hear people say how, even though we're not together, even though we're joining from all over the place, in fact all over the world, they really feel that sense of togetherness and really feel that sense of God speaking to them deeply. And it's really wonderful to see that in the comments. So it is our prayer this morning that that is what you would feel, that you would feel a warm sense of welcome coming from here at Plymouth Methodist Central Hall right into your front room or into the passenger seat of your car
or
on the M6 or wherever you might be. We pray that you would feel that warm fellowship, that love of God zooming right in to wherever you're joining from this morning. It's great to welcome loads and loads of people in this. We zoom in to 11 o'clock. It's our job to just say a very, very warm welcome once again, wherever you might be joining from. And we really hope that you enjoy worshipping with us today.
You're going to pass over to Gareth?
Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you. Thank you, Paul and Nick, for warming us up and regaling us of tales of IKEA and other such exciting things. It was such a beautiful day yesterday. We went to the beach. Other people went to a big warehouse, furniture warehouse upcountry. But you make your judgment as to who's the classier couple here. But there we are. It's good to see you. And a really warm welcome to worship this morning, broadcasting from Methodist Central Hall. If you're just joining us, it's great to see you. And whether you're part of our congregation, whether you live in and around Plymouth, or as we've discovered, whether you're watching from all over the place, you are very, very welcome today, and it's really great to have you with us. Should we just pause and be still for a moment, wherever we are, even if we're driving up the motorway, let's just settle our hearts for a moment and just deliberately kind of tune our mind and our gaze and our soul towards the Lord. And we want to meet with him as we worship. We want to meet with him as we sit under his word. We want to meet with him as we pray. So let's just ask him for that. That he would draw near to us as we draw near to him. Lord, meet us today as we worship you. Meet us today as we pray and read your word. Meet us today and transform us and change us and fill us again with your presence and with your life. Meet us, Jesus, we pray. In your name, amen. Let's worship together, shall we? We're going to sing a couple of songs. Why not join in wherever you are as we worship the Lord?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Love is mighty, it's so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is a amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in our life. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Build your kingdom here.
Wonderful, and that's what we want, isn't it, for the reign and rule of God to come in our midst, in our lives, and across our world. Let's pray together, shall we? God, our Father, we long for that day when the earth will be filled with the glory of God as the waters cover the sea. That day when you reign and rule over all, and all of creation acknowledge it's you as Lord and God and King of the universe. We look for the day when, as St. Paul tells us, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And so we this morning, wherever we are set, gather our voices and gather our minds and our hearts and our bodies and join in with the song of our musicians and indeed the song of all of creation in saying, you are Lord God Almighty, and we worship you and we adore you and we gaze upon your wonder. And we acknowledge you to be the one who is high and lifted up, the only one worthy of all honor and glory and praise and thanks and wisdom and power and strength. But Lord, we know that it's easy for us to gather in a time of worship or to focus on worship and say amen to the prayers. We realize that as we live our lives out in the world, that each day we make choices that contradict the attitude of our heart and the confession of our lips. Lord, we take time to acknowledge our sinfulness. We take time to acknowledge the mistakes that we've made. We confess them to you. And we choose to turn away from them now, knowing that as we repent, we find in you grace which abounds, forgiveness which abounds, love which abounds, a gracious welcome that is indescribable. We thank you that because Jesus died on the cross and because you raised him from the dead, his word to us now is not one of condemnation or accusation, but is one of pardon, saying, your sins are forgiven. Go in peace. We receive his grace afresh today over our lives, covering all of our sin. And we seek with expectation, the infilling of your Holy Spirit to empower us and equip us to live differently from this moment on. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It's great to see you if you've joined us in the last few minutes. It's great to welcome you to worship from Methodist Central Hall here in Plymouth. My name's Gareth. I'm the lead minister here. And there's various other people in the building with me that you can't really see at the moment who are here assisting us with the offering of worship today. And you'll see Mark and Anne assisting us a little later on with our closing hymn. If you're new to the city, particularly if you're a student, can I extend a very warm welcome to you personally? And you may want to check out our live service feed in the coming weeks, or even our back catalogue on YouTube, just to get a flavour of what this church is about. And over the next couple of weeks, we'll be in our 11 o'clock service, just showing some videos from people that are going from here to university out of our youth group, and also a number of stories from some of our students who have come to Plymouth and have become part of this church and found that to be a help to them as they settle and pursue their own Christian faith here. So you'll be hearing more about that over the next 2 weeks in our 11 o'clock broadcast and on our YouTube channel. Just a reminder to anybody watching that if you did want to meet physically for worship, our quiet and reflective service led by Deacon Linda has plenty of space still for this evening. So that means on the whole, you're likely to be able to turn up and get in. We do have a limit of around 35, as many of you will know. And at the minute, we're about half capacity. So if anybody would like to turn up and on the off chance, join us for worship tonight, very quiet, meditative, meditative style, then Deacon Linda will be glad to see you. I'll be here as well. I'll be glad to see you and to welcome you to worship today. And then our Bible study meets on Tuesday. I know a number of folk were concerned that the government's rule of six would prohibit that from happening. The latest guidance we have is that places of worship are exempt from that ruling. And so we expect our Bible study to continue in person, though socially distanced and heavily restricted from what it usually is. But the Bible study will continue in person at 2 p.m. on Tuesday for the foreseeable future. And once more, there's lots of space still to join in with that. If you'd like to come, please ideally sign up for this week. It would help us with the track and trace process if we knew who was coming. And if you would like to ring the church office between 9 and 1 tomorrow, Monday or Tuesday, just to let us know that you're coming, that would be really helpful. This week, Johnny Libby is taking the study, so I'm sure that will result in an upturn of people wanting to come. And we're continuing our new series on Daniel. And as last week, you'll be able to see the teaching uploaded a little later on in the week if you weren't able to make it. Just visit our YouTube channel and you'll find all of our back catalogue, so to speak, including the midweek reflections, Bible studies, etc., on there, which may be of some use to you. We're going to pray together now for ourselves and for the wider world. So let's pray together. God, our Father, we thank you so much for the invitation that you give us to come boldly before your throne, to seek your grace and your mercy, and to find fresh grace just when we need it. And Lord, as we've no doubt felt many times over the last 6 months, this appears to be a moment where, as a nation, indeed as a whole global community, and certainly as individuals, we are very much in need of your grace right where we need it just now. Lord, we continue to pray for the health and well-being of this land as people return to school and return to university. We know that many people will be afraid and fearful given the upturn in infection rates due to COVID-19. Many people will be nervous sending loved ones either back to university or off for the first time. Many people in the health care professions will be worried about the upturn in demand once more. And so, Lord, we place into your hands, as the old chorus says, those things which we cannot do, and we seek your deliverance, and we seek your healing, and we seek your protection from this horrible virus. We continue to pray for scientists and advisors that are advising the government and other people who are making significant policy decisions. We pray that you'd give them energy and clarity, that you'd give them wisdom and grace, that all of their training and all of their expertise would come to the fore for such a time as this. We echo that for those that are working in the health service, those who are seeking to protect others and treat others and relieve them of illness, those in the care system who are serving the most vulnerable. We pray for your grace for each of them, that you would sustain them, that you would bless them, and that you would keep them at this difficult and troubling time. We pray for those who are recommencing vaccination trials in Oxford and other sites all over the world. We pray for their success. And again, Lord God, would you use the skill and education and training of scientists and researchers in order that the horrible effects of this virus might be mitigated and pushed back before too long. Continue to pray for those who are fearful of their future. Perhaps their job or their housing is insecure as a result of the economic and social upheaval. We pray, Lord, for your peace. pray for those who are seeking a new place to live, that you would grant them great grace and great wisdom, and help them to know that you are leading them to their next step. For those that are fearful about their employment, would you stand with them, Lord? Would you enable them to know that employed or not employed, they are no less valuable or precious to you or to the human race? Help them to know that we're not valued by what we do, but by who we are. We pray for an upturn in infrastructure to support people transitioning between employment to find new patterns and rhythms of work. Continue to pray for our ministry at the food bank, and we thank you for all that's been able to happen there during the lockdown and the way that we've been able to serve the most vulnerable people in the city. And we pray for Maria and Andrew, for Ryan and for Sue, and for all the volunteers, that you would continue to equip them and resource them, that they might have the energy and the focus and the drive to continue to serve the least, the last and the lost of our city. Continue to pray too for the life of your church across the world, but especially here. We pray as the Bible study picks up, as the soft play reopens, as children's groups begin to think about coming back. We pray, Lord, for wisdom, for discernment. Pray that we would you would keep us from rushing back to what was normal just for the sake of it, and you would give us discernment to know when to press ahead and when to pause. Lord, we thank you for your sustaining power. We thank you for your strengthening hand. And as we pray today, we pray with confidence, knowing that you are the good God who meets us at our point of need, and who is always seeking to transform and to renew and to refresh. And so we make all our prayers in and through the name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. Amen. I'm going to turn to God's word now, which this week is from Luke chapter 19. And I think the text will appear on your screen as I read it, which is wonderful. And this is a familiar text, the story of Jesus and Zacchaeus. And we're going to be using this text just to think about our ongoing series, week two, on discipleship, as we reflect on it together. So, Luke 19 and verse 1. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He's gone to the house to be a guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." We thank God for his word to us. We're going to sing again together before we consider God's word more closely. and I think the song is called Broken Vessels, and Nick and Paul will lead us.
Broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken, I've been set free.
As a result of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So next time when I pray, I'll remember to turn the microphone on, but some of you will have gathered that. I'm simply asking God to come and meet us as we looked into his word. I'm at the age where I've got a number of a couple of children who are in the school play kind of age group. And so whether it's from nursery time or through reception, they have, or foundation as it seems to be called down here, they have had their Christmas shows or their school assemblies. And there's just something about a crowd of parents or grandparents or great aunt Mildred's or whatever watching their little cherubs in school plays that turns the most serene parents into this kind of raging mob as they fight and elbow each other to get the best view of little Jimmy or little Annie saying her one line to the best of her ability. I had a friend of mine once who would, whatever the occasion, would always get there ridiculously early and kind of nib the best seat at the front every single time, just so that they could get the best seat. It mattered to them so much. And of course, with that friend and in lots of other kind of areas of life, sometimes it takes great effort to get the view that you really want. So I was speaking to somebody yesterday who was just telling me that when the lunar eclipse happened in 1999, they clambered up to a seat on the cliff at the bay at Loo in order that they could get this great view, which they did. But it takes effort often to get the view that you want. And here in this text, Zacchaeus is determined to get the view that he wants. It's important to him that he sees Jesus. Presumably, he has heard much about him. He wants to, he's heard Jesus is coming this way, and Jesus' reputation has gone before him. So Zacchaeus needs to get a good spot, he thinks. So up he climbs a sycamore tree. Verse 4, he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. You see, it's interesting, isn't it, that Zacchaeus only wants to see Jesus from a safe distance. He just wants to visually see him. He's got no thought that they might actually have a conversation or any interaction whatsoever. He is just keen to make sure he can say, yep, that day in Jericho, I saw him. A bit like we might be if the Queen came to our town or city. Although I doubt that she'd ever want to come down here, but there we are. Zacchaeus just wants to see Jesus from a safe distance. Maybe he's curious. But notice that Jesus makes a bit of an effort too. It's not just Zacchaeus that goes to lengths to get a good view. Jesus wants to do the same. He's also intentional. Jesus seeks out a meeting with Zacchaeus. Jesus seeks out a conversation. Jesus seeks out an encounter, whether Zacchaeus wanted that or not. When Jesus reached the spot, verse 5 says, he looked up and said to him, it's a deliberate action, Zacchaeus, get down immediately. I must stay at your house today. Now, I have a reputation for inviting myself to lunch at various places. The Morrises and the Whittells and other people have graciously taken up that self-invitation. But Jesus does that par excellence here, doesn't he? He sees Zacchaeus, he spots him, and then invites himself to his house. And so Zacchaeus is forced not just to look from a distance safely, but he's forced to meet Jesus. Zacchaeus is forced to meet Jesus. We're looking in the first half of this autumn at what it means to be a disciple. What does it mean to live out one's discipleship? Well, I said last week that discipleship begins with following Jesus. I realized as I was preparing this week that that was completely wrong. You can't follow somebody you've not met. So discipleship, secondly, is about following, but it's firstly about meeting. Discipleship begins with meeting Jesus. It's as a result of meeting him that we choose whether we want to follow him or not. But the good thing that this text tells us is that as much as we might be seeking out a meeting with Jesus, he is already seeking out a meeting with us. The Bible says, draw near to God, for he is already drawing near to you. Whenever we make an engagement or an intentional and deliberate step towards God, we are simply replicating what God has already done towards us. So if we're seeking a meeting with Jesus, we can be confident that he too is seeking a meeting with us. He's ready and willing to meet with us. So if discipleship then is about meeting Jesus, when did you last meet with Jesus? You know, online church can be wearying. And to an extent like never before, we are now having to take responsibility for our own discipleship. Now, you know, I've loved, as I've said before, the opportunity we have that we didn't have in February, for instance, to engage with people all over the world like we're doing this morning and every single week. It's great that somebody who is travelling up the M6 to either collect or deposit their mother doesn't have to, quote, miss church, but can join with the Fellowship of Believers. Another member of our church staff is in Lincolnshire at the minute. And the fact that we're online means that they can join in as much as anybody here in Plymouth can join in. That is great. We praise God for that. We thank God for both the technology that enables it to do it, to do that, and the expertise and the skills and the willingness of volunteers who give their time and energy and creativity in order that we can make that happen. We thank God for it. But if you're anything like me, it's helpful, but it's just not the same. And there's a longing in me that when it's safe and responsible to do so, a longing to engage with people in the group once again, to sit with people, to worship with people, particularly to sing with people. And I know from chatting to some of you in the week, we share that common desire and longing. And so there is a sense that looking at a screen can be a bit wearying. But it's causing us, and this may be challenging, but I think it's a gift of God to take responsibility for our own discipleship like never before. Because things will not be laid on for us. We're unable to put church services on to do the work for us like we did before. And so if we want to meet Jesus, it requires effort. It requires deliberate action, very much like it did for Zacchaeus. And so then, while we're separate, how is it that we meet with Jesus? How do we take responsibility for that meeting? Well, the spiritual disciplines are given to us by God to keep us having the opportunity to meet Jesus. If you're not in the practice of reading your Bible regularly, can I encourage you to do so? Maybe start with one of the Gospels and just read a little bit a day, or maybe start with one of the Psalms and read just a little bit a day. And as you do so, ask the Lord to meet you in His Word. That's what I do. It's a very simple practice at the minute that I read a chapter of a devotional book, reading some stuff by Smith Wigglesworth at the minute. And then I simply sit with a Bible passage and say, Lord, would you meet me in your word? That's all. There's no great liturgical or professional Christian prayer that I pray. Just say, Lord, would you meet me in your word? And then I usually read a little passage, and I perhaps read it three or four times over. And then I might just sit quietly, not trying to be distracted by anything else, and just mull over what I've read. And you know, sometimes there is this wonderful revelation, and I think, wow, I've never seen that before. And other times I think, oh well, and on we go. But it puts me in the kind of arena or the state of mind, I guess, or even the state of soul, dare I say it, of being available to God to meet with Him. Similarly, prayer doesn't need to be great poetic stuff, but regular prayer, coming into the presence of God, ready to meet with Him, fasting, giving up meals, setting aside food and pressing into God, simply being silent and still, maybe listening to a wonderful piece of music, All opportunities that are in our hands to meet with Jesus. And if we want our discipleship to be living and vibrant and fresh, then we need to take as much responsibility as beholds us at our end of the bargain to keep meeting with Jesus. Zacchaeus makes the effort that's required, however inconvenient. And are you willing to do the same? Discipleship begins with meeting Jesus. He's seeking you out. Are you deliberately seeking him out? And secondly, as a result of meeting Jesus, there is transformation in Zacchaeus' life. And so Zacchaeus, as a result of a simple meal, just spending time in the presence of Jesus, changes his whole modus operandi. His entire outlook and practice of doing life is completely about turned. Now, no, we've got no record of Jesus saying anything specific here. There's no great sermon or great verbal treatise that Jesus gives that Luke records for us. And we think if there was something hugely significant and deep, Luke, who is the most detailed of the gospel writers, would most likely have given us that. But we don't see it. But we are to see that the very encounter, the very meeting with Jesus is enough to bring radical transformation in the life of Zacchaeus. Now, if you've got your Bible open, you may have it or you may not, you would just look in the last chapter. We're in chapter 19 today, in Luke chapter 18, from verse 18 onwards, there is another person who meets Jesus. They're also wealthy, like Zacchaeus. They're often known as the rich young ruler. They both meet Jesus. One goes away sad, resisting or perhaps declining the transformation and change that Jesus offered, whereas Zacchaeus embraces all that Jesus offers. We're meant to contrast the two. We're meant to be reading these passages and thinking, which one do we want to be? Do we want to be like Zacchaeus? Everything changes. Joyful generosity just overflows. He can't contain it. Or do we want to be like the rich young ruler who resists what Jesus offers and walks away sad? No, Zacchaeus models repentance well. He embraces the transformation on offer. He was at the top of the tree in terms of tax collecting. He'd become wealthy through corruption and extortion and ill-gotten gains. He was renowned for being a man of wealth on the backs of the poor. That's why the people, notice verse 7, it's not the usual candidates, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the teachers of the law who are muttering about where Jesus spends his time. This time it's all the people saw this and began to mutter, he's gone to the house to be a guest of a sinner. But after one meeting with Jesus, total transformation occurs. And look what Zacchaeus does. He doesn't deny his past. Doesn't brush it under the carpet. He takes responsibility for it. And he seeks to put it right. Verse 8. Look, Lord, here and now, I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. So Zacchaeus takes responsibility for his corrupt past. He acknowledges that he indeed has cheated people, and therefore it's up to him to put it right. He goes over and above what the law required in terms of reparation, but it's up to him to make sure that things are settled. You know, often preachers like me and the church have failed to define what repentance is really about. Repentance is not a change of heart. It is not feeling regret or sorrow. It is not even the confession of sin. But repentance is an action that demonstrates real change. My app that I use for SatNav continues to play up at the minute. It keeps thinking I'm going backwards. So I'm proceeding along the road and it keeps telling me that I'm going in the opposite direction. And particularly on major roads, it keeps telling me regularly to make a U-turn. And what it wants me to do is to completely and utterly change direction because it's mistaken and thinks I'm going entirely the wrong way. Repentance then, which emanates out of a meeting with Jesus, is a real conscious about turn. It is a total reorientation of one's priorities and lives. And one dinner with Jesus is enough for radical reorientation in the life of Zacchaeus. Now, in Zacchaeus, this is the only time we hear of him in Luke's gospel. He doesn't come up again. But actually, for many of us, we will need to keep making those U-turns every single day. And the way to become more aware of when they are needed is to keep having a regular, vibrant meeting with Jesus that prompts change and transformation in us, that we ensure we're not living the way of selfishness and greed, but that we're living in the way of Christ. And then lastly, Zacchaeus meets Jesus. There's a reorientation of life. And what happens next? Well, we don't know what happens next. But it seems that Zacchaeus lives out his discipleship right where he is. There's no mention that Zacchaeus follows Jesus physically. He doesn't join the band of followers that are heading to Jerusalem. He testifies to a renewed life there in Jericho, it seems. Getting on with it. Living differently right in the midst of the people that would have known what he used to be like. That's a challenge, isn't it? That's a challenge. It's one thing to screw up and move somewhere else where you can make a fresh start, and that's perfectly fine and legitimate. Please don't get me wrong. But it's tough, isn't it, to screw up big time and then continue to live out your remodeled life in the same community who you abused and ripped off and extorted wealth from. Imagine the amount of trust that Zacchaeus would have to rebuild. Imagine, doesn't even say that he left being a tax collector. Imagine next time he knocked on the door saying, right, it's tax time. Imagine how people would look at him as he called in the various rate. You see, for Zacchaeus, discipleship doesn't mean physically leaving Jericho and following Jesus anywhere, but it means for him imitating his life, living the Jesus way there in Jericho where he was. And you might say, well, what does it mean to live the Jesus way? I don't really know what that means. That's a bit of a cliche. Well, in the comments section right about now, you will see a link to our series on the Sermon on the Mount. It's a whole load of YouTube videos which we recorded during the spring, and some of you would have seen them. But it goes through what it means to live like Jesus. What are the values that Jesus values? What are the priorities that Jesus prioritized? What is the set of conduct or the complete kind of manual of conduct that Jesus looks for in his discipleship, in his disciples, and the people that are growing to live more like Jesus? And if you haven't already, you may want to check those out. It means being generous. It means being prayerful. It means watching what you say. It means being faithful to your vows. It means looking at people through the lens of God, valuing them as beautiful creatures, not as people to possess or lust over or control. You see, living the Jesus way is nothing other than an entirely Jesus-orientated existence. And the key point I want to draw to a close with today is this, that we then, like Zacchaeus seems to, are invited, challenged, commanded, whatever word you want to put there, to live like Jesus right where you are. And so if you're a parent, and that's where the stage of life you're at the moment, parent as Jesus would parent. If you're in employment and you've got responsibilities in your job, work as Jesus would work if he was doing your job. Care as Jesus would care. Be faithful and diligent as Jesus would be diligent. You see, we are to live out the Sermon on the Mount, the way of Jesus, not just in the orbit of church premises or church activities where we kind of put our game face on, right, it's religious day, come on then, let's have best behavior. But we're to live out the Jesus way, a transformed life, wherever the Lord has distributed us. In our close, in our cul-de-sac, in our avenue, in our office, in our university or school community, we're to live out the life of Jesus where we are. People who meet Jesus, therefore are transformed by Jesus and live out his way. Can you imagine the impact that Zacchaeus would have had on the town of Jericho? Can you imagine what people saw in him as he pursued this life of faithfulness? And if only we could have a similar impact on where God has set us. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the impact we could have in our workplace, in our school, in our uni, in our family, amongst our neighbours? If only we could have a similar impact on individuals, communities, and the city of Plymouth. You see, God's process and purpose of transforming individuals, communities, and the city of Plymouth comes from transforming us. As we, out of a meeting with Jesus, lived transformed lives, so the effect of that ripples out like ripples on a pond, bringing transformation to others. And we live transformed lives by regular meeting with Jesus, by continuing to live the U-turned life where the values and the mindset of Jesus is inhabited and exhibited more and more in who we are. And then we're sent, perhaps to not very glamorous places, but sent nonetheless to our family, our street, our school, our workplace, our social group, our soft play cafe, our discovery centre, wherever it might be, we are sent nonetheless with the hope that us who continue to meet with Jesus will live out that transformed life where we are, that might overflow to other people who will notice, be convicted, even want some of that transformation for themselves, that individuals and communities in the city and indeed the world might look very different from this moment on. Amen. Amen. Before we rush on to our closing hymn, which we're going to share in together in a moment, let's just, wherever we are, Just take a breath. Just think. Or just still our mind. I'm simply asking you today, all of this begins, the transformed life, all begins by meeting Jesus. And so do you need to meet Jesus today? He's ready. He's looking for us like he was looking for Zacchaeus. So wherever you are, whether you're on the M6 or walking on the beach or sat on the sofa, I just invite you, just where you are, just to hold out your hands. I've said this lots of times before. This isn't like some magic formula that if we do A and B, then God always does C. But I find it helpful just to show that I'm receptive and open. And in some ways, you know, if I sit there on my sofa like this, I just don't feel like I'm saying to God, I'm quite as open. So why not join me just opening your hands in a receptive pose as though you're just going to, you know, receive something. And I'm just going to pray on behalf of all of us watching. Lord Jesus, would you meet with us now? Would you meet with us now? Would you breathe peace into troubled minds and souls? Would you meet with us, Jesus? Where we feel disconnected and disengaged with church because of the model that we're using at the moment, would you breathe this life and freshness into us? Meet with us, Jesus, we pray. Where we're weary because the holiday was cancelled in the hope that just a few months down the line we might be able to get away, but we're looking with exasperation down through the autumn now. Would you meet with us, Jesus? Would you breathe life? And as you meet us, Lord, would you fill us with joy and with thanksgiving, with peace and with wholeness? And would you infuse us afresh with the power of your Spirit, that you might work transformation in us, that the world might be changed? For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hope that's been helpful today. A reminder that there is still space for worship tonight and Bible study on Tuesday. Tonight you can just turn up and hope for the best. Helpful for Tuesday if you'd ring in Monday or Tuesday morning between 9 and 1 to let us know that you are coming. We're going to close our time today by singing a great hymn. Why don't you stand wherever you're watching, whether it's in the garden or in the living room, or probably if you're in the M6, it's a bit difficult. But wherever you are, why not stand and belt out this wonderful hymn with us? I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Just pictured as we were singing that, as just Mark and Anne here on the stage, and pictured dozens of you all over Plymouth in your front rooms, belting out the words of that wonderful, wonderful hymn. It won't be long, I'm sure, before we can gather again and lift up our voices to give God praise and glory together. But for the meantime, wherever you are, a blessing to close. May the blessing of God, who is Father and Son and Holy Spirit, be upon you and around you and amongst you this day and every day. Amen. Have a great week, folks.